for 5 weeks open to turn it around and hire thousands of teachers, education workers, and custodians so that all kids can return to school in the fall full time, but in smaller, safer classes, which is what we have been asking for 4 months. And this plan is a massive failure on all fronts.
Okay, elementary school students back full time. Some high schoolers in class part time. Masks mandatory for kids in grades 4 to 12. That is just some of the back to school plan announced by the province yesterday. But a lot of questions and a lot of concerns coming from parents and educators alike as we continue to figure this all out. Joining me now to hopefully answer some of those questions is Education Minister Stephen Lecce. Good morning to you, Minister.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Yeah. And I will speak for parents. I have a son that's going into kindergarten and I am concerned. I'm concerned, as are a lot of people right now. I want to get right to questions because we put it out on social media and we were flooded. One of the biggest things being class sizes, elementary school, going back full time to that model, 5 days a week, no caps on class sizes, whereas something like high school is being capped to 15. What is the rationale behind that? Because I know 4-year-olds, 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds, the physical distancing for them, as much as you want to try with a teacher, not necessarily going to happen.
Yeah, thank you so much for that question. Look, I mean, our plan was based on the best medical and scientific advice, the emerging advice presented to governments about how to keep kids safe. And what I can tell you is, when it comes to grades 1 to 3, in this province, we have a cap at 20. It's the lowest in the nation. No province in this country has adjusted their caps or their class sizes. But what we've done is we've ensured that there's $30 million provisioned in our plan to hire more educators to ensure social distancing can be achieved. In addition, yes, we in kindergarten, as you will know, the classroom sizes have to be, the classroom physical space actually has to be larger in those classes than, for example, in high school or in grade 7 or 8. The physical space is larger and the staffing is at a ratio of 13 to 1. There's 2 educators, at least 1 EC historically, and 1 teacher in that classroom. So there's a higher rate of staff. More importantly, we put in place higher hygiene, custodial cleaning, and about 1,300 new custodians to clean those very classrooms to keep them safe and ultimately de-risk the circumstance for both the staff, but likewise for these kids.
Minister, we've heard from a lot of parents and educators. So let's back up into the early part of the day, even just busing students to school. Sometimes in some municipalities, you have 3 kids in 1 seat. And for them to be designated a seat and then they're in the mix with other students there, are these cohorts actually going to work?
You know, the cohorting principle is really vital to the plan. It's what both, was advised to us by the medical officers and as well by the pediatric communities to ensure the grouping, the integrity of it. And it can be done in elementary school most effectively. When it comes to busing, we believe that the sort of element of success is ensuring that they're constantly clean. These touch points are cleaned, which is why we provisioned $40 million more to do just that and to make sure that in addition to the cleaning, that there's assigned seating as well on these buses, which will help limit that spread. Siblings could be in the same seat, whereas it'd be one individual, one child per seat otherwise. So there are protocols in place to keep the kids safe, but the cleaning element, the new money for cleaning, will certainly help in that respect.
Indeed, there's the money for the cleaning, but what about staffing? I mean, who's going to monitor all of this? We had some concerns.
We want to do that in September and beyond.
Because there is no testing happening at school with the thermometers per se, it's left in the hands of parents. We're going to move into flu season. And these symptoms are very similar, COVID and flu. How do we leave it in the hands of parents and to their discretion to say what is what? And I mean, really, it's a bit of a kerfuffle here. And parents are left in a bit of a bind.
Well, you know, parents always have to make a judgment call, especially in the context of influenza, about knowing the symptoms of keeping their kids home. We have a self-assessment tool that's going to help parents do that ultimately and fundamentally. But I think where we're aided and where we're uniquely advantaged in Ontario is the fact that we have public health nurses that are going to help teachers understand that screening process and the signs and when to encourage that child to be removed from the class, isolated because of symptoms, and that triggers a variety of actions, including calling public health, calling the parents, and advising the school board, and ultimately involving those public health nurses as a way to deal with symptoms and likewise of helping to test them. We're also encouraging parents to get their child's vaccines done ahead of September across the board, but as you noted, particularly for the flu season. I just spoke to the Minister of Education, New South Wales, last night in Australia. Their flu season has hit them now because of the difference in time zones. And, you know, their experience and their lessons learned in for Ontario, at least, is two things. One is you need to have aggressive cleaning. We've added $50 million to hire 1,300 custodians. And two, you need to ensure contact tracing is robust and solid. And we have that in place where these cohorts will be maintained and isolated. And we think that will, together, the full suite, Melanie, of options we're putting in place on top of masking will help these kids keep as safe as humanly possible when it comes to September.
Minister, I know you have a tough job, so I don't envy you, and I know you're doing your best, but realistically, I'm looking at just mask wearing in general. You look at some older schools. There are a lot of schools that do not have air conditioning. You have portables. How realistic is it to have students wearing masks for a full day in heat?
You know, I appreciate, you know, the masking elements and sort of that irritation it can impose wearing them for many hours. I mean, I get that. But at the end of the day, when it comes to the best advice we have in this country, it's that masking, in addition to some element of distancing and hand hygiene and other actions together, will create an element of safety. And so we're going to permit, you know, in recess and lunch, teachers are going to be instructed to encourage sort of a bit of a mask break where they're distanced from each other, you know, taking classrooms outside into the schoolyard, create a bit of that experiential learning, but also reduce the irritation associated perhaps with wearing it for a prolonged period. But fundamentally speaking, Melanie, I understand. But at the end of the day, I have to make decisions based on public health advice. And that advice, including from SickKids, is that it is effective to introduce masking, especially for those students in grade 9 and up. But they've also suggested it is important for that middle school component and less effective for the kids in the elementary, in the kindergarten to grade 3 panel. And so we are going to do whatever it takes, including some of these tough decisions to keep the kids safe. But if we can get them back and have that social emotional development, have access to mental health supports and be together learning again, that is an important, I think, decision point we've made that's, from a global perspective, really important to their development and their health and wellness.
Minister, you know, the big question is, what if someone gets sick? So what if a student gets sick, a teacher gets sick? What happens when it comes to isolation? Does a whole class have to then self-isolate? What is the protocol?
Yeah, there is a an outbreak management protocol laid out in the guidance. Obviously, if there is a positive test, that class, the contact tracing element, comes into place immediately. All of those individuals would be isolated for 14 days. They would be tested and, of course, supported with any symptom relief that would be required. So that protocol is in place. It's very granular. The reason why we're taking the cohorting approach is that we're able to really target that class versus that school and reduce that impact on the larger population and the students around them. Obviously, public health will play a critical role. Communication to parents will be vital. And really leveraging sort of that wraparound service for these kids, getting them access to whatever treatment they will need. The fact that we have a rapid deploy team of nurses that can get in there and provide that support in conjunction with public health, I think is a unique element that really needs to be you know, further emphasized, because we have the ability to move health assets where they are needed to respond to those challenges, wherever those outbreaks may be. And we're going to do that.
Minister, we heard from the president of SickKids yesterday about the recommendations, those guidelines provided, which I know you did take into account. And he said it is a living, breathing document. They made revisions from their original document in early June. Are you willing to make any revisions to this current plan before school starts? Because a lot can change in the next 5-6 weeks.
I honestly think, Melanie, being transparent about the fact that this virus is changing, and that we have to ensure that our plan evolves with it and is responsive to the risk that is changing, that is not linear province-wide. And I think it's a fair question, and the answer is yes. I mean, there's emerging evidence on a variety of elements, and we're looking jurisdictionally around the world to learn from those mistakes of other places and not repeat them in this province. And so I think it is fair to say this plan will change over time. It will respond to the risks as they emerge, and we'll continue to be there, including from the context of mental health, to ensure that these kids get access to those services. It's why the Premier and I announced an additional $20 million investment to hire more psychologists and psychotherapists. It's an example of the reality. We put $10 million in a month ago, Melanie, but when we heard there's a dramatic need for access to service, we adjusted the plan again. And we'll continue to do that, I think, just to be as responsive as we can to the risk.
I think it's fair to say, you know, a lot of our educators, of course, are parents as well, and there is concern across the board. I know this is step one, and we'll have to see how this goes, but hopefully we can touch base prior to school beginning and see where things stand. Education Minister Stephen Lecce, we appreciate you joining us. Thank you.
Thank you.